I came to know about Principal Wright in a rather unusual way. Would you want to know how I came to know about Cliff? Well, what happened was that I got a certain letter from Spencerville Academy, I think by his secretary, in which there's an inquiry being made about how to get students, more students enrolled in Spencerville Academy. And I was quite impressed by that letter, by the humility, by the eagerness, by the, I don't know what, how to categorize it, but I was impressed to find out more about who this, you know, principal, vice principal was. So I did some research online, and then I came to know that, you know, he's more than just a vice principal. You know, he has his own talk show, he has been involved in, you know, social matters, you know, today's Social Matters Day, and so I also came across his him speaking at Appleton Church, and I decided to listen to the whole, you know, sermon. It was a high school program of some sort, and I was impressed even more to find out if you know, Brother Cliff Wright will be interested in speaking at HopeSide. And so I simply took the, you know, opportunity to write to him and say, you know what, we have a small mission here, but we are trying something different for outreach, so we can do things in a slightly different way. Would you be interested in speaking, you know, at our church? Who knows, on a regular basis. And I didn't hear from him for about 2 or 3 weeks, but then I got the email. And I'm sure he's very busy with as it is, with his family, and Spencerville Academy and talks and all those things, and he said that he would be available to speak. So I was quite ecstatic about meeting him, and I met him. And in the email, as you can see here, he said, you know, he ended his email by saying, "Simple servant." Now, that impressed me even more. That is what is needed, simpleness to serve. The mission itself is actually very simple. But unless we are able to be simple in serving, you know, we may not be able to see the progress that can be made. So I would like to thank Principal Cliff Wright Jr. and his family for making themselves available first and second week of every month. I know it may not be that easy to do this, but you know, we will try. We are piloting something. We have some other things that we want to try to be effective in reaching out to the community. And so I would like to truly thank him for coming here. And as you know, he's also related to Pastor Andrew Wright. How many of you know that? Well, now you know. Pastor Andrew Wright is one of the great speakers, evangelists, whatever you want to call him. He has his own story. He is a pastor of Tacoma Park Church. And in fact, this church, when it was first started, it started through Tacoma Park Church, even though we're in Allegheny, Wisconsin now. But it was Tacoma Park Church who made it possible for us to rent this place in the beginning, 2011. And so many things have happened, as you all know. We are always trying to build our mission and our outreach. And let's hope and pray that God will use each of us, and especially through the dynamic speaking ability of Cliff Wright to inspire us and go forward. So once again, thank you, Principal Wright, for making yourself available. So after the scripture reading, the next person you will, and the theme song, the next person you'll hear is Principal Cliff Wright Jr.
Amen.
Amen.
The scripture reading for today is Galatians 5:2-6. "Behold, I, Paul, say unto you, that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised, that if he be to the whole law, Christ is become to whoever, if he be justified by Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith without work, which worketh by love. Sorry, I didn't get that.
But I was a dean, and then God just kept opening doors, And this whole commitment of just surrendering myself and going where he wants me to be has me in front of you today. So hopefully that will be okay. Currently, I am the high school assistant principal at Spencer Adventist Academy, about 10 minutes away from here over in Burnsville. It's a pre-K to 12 school. Brian Kilson is our head principal. Ms. Judy Rosa is over the K to 8 program, and I'm over the 9 to 12 program. I also, as was mentioned, I've been on a hiatus for about 8 months right now from an internet talk show that I have called Cliff Notes. When I was a consultant, an educational consultant, it was real easy to set my own schedule. I was on Monday through Friday, doing the show, talking. It's funny how when you become a principal, your schedule shifts as far as your availability to do some different things. So I scaled it down to just Friday mornings, and I did one show, and I was like, yes, Friday mornings. And then I scaled it on back to, I'll let you guys know when I can come back. But in that process, I did move the studio into the school. And so it's a learning process for our students, and I'm in the process of training students to be producers of shows. And so now I have a producer of my show where I can just come in and talk. So it may come back before the school year ends. I don't know. My passion is mentoring. I just happen to be a principal. So in everything I do, whether it's mentoring people, mentoring young people, mentorship at its truest form in me is discipleship. And so regardless of what hat or title I wear, to me, some people look at, well, you're doing a lot. I look at it, I'm just doing one thing, what God has called me to do. It's interesting that back in 1862, the title of my message is The Gospel Process. The Gospel Process. Back in 1862, there was an important decision made in this country. Incredible, courageous action. Most of you know that. Hopefully all of you know that on September 22nd, President Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. It went into effect on January 1st, 1863. So the moment it went into effect, legally, every slave in the Confederacy was free. But until they knew their freedom, that decision had no impact on their life. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, thank you for an opportunity to serve. Speak through me now. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So slaves were free, but that freedom meant nothing to them. In fact, it wouldn't mean anything to them if they didn't believe it or accept it. And it was actually, as you look at it, the Union soldiers carried hundreds of thousands of documents to say it's true. When you've gone through, you know, that piece, the fact that someone makes a decision, it's not like today. There's no internet, there's no social media. There's a decision made over here, and from the moment it signed in, freedom. But for all the people that were slaves, many of them didn't know it. And those that did had to choose to either believe it, and what if that's wrong? What are the consequences of that? So there's a lot of things tied to that. Our scripture today comes from the book of Galatians. Paul writes the book of Galatians to a people that find themselves caught in the middle. They're starting to struggle. This is at a time of early converts. You know, Paul's ministry was predominantly to the Gentiles. That's actually us, but prominently to the Gentiles, right? So you have these people that are Jews, right, of the Jewish faith, and they're accepting Jesus, but their approach was law-based. Everything that we're told to do, you know, there were 600, a little over 600 laws just around the Sabbath. How many steps to take, what you can and can't do. So it was a very works-based scenario. And so when we look in Galatians, we find that the early Christians were kind of caught with, okay, now Paul's bringing in these non-Jewish people. They can be circumcised. That's the law. That's what has to happen. You can't just accept Jesus. You have to accept Jesus and then do these types of things. ironically, it's a little familiar to, in some respects, how we are today. You can get baptized, come into the Adventist Church, but then there's a whole lot of expectations as to if you really love Christ. A lot of it centers on how you look, what you do, what you drink, how you spend your time, how you interact with each other. So there's some similarities. They were conditioned to follow the law, but they had accepted Christ. And when they accepted Christ, he invited them to fall into him, which was a holy liberty. They wondered to themselves how the Gentiles could even be a part of the kingdom of heaven. So this is all within the same church. Does that remind you of any type of church today? Maybe not. Maybe it'll remind you a little later. We'll see. It was tearing the church apart, and the Jewish followers were constantly telling Gentile believers to submit to the Jewish laws, and because Paul was witnessing to the Gentiles, he had to write several letters. The letter to Galatians is one of them, to try and get the people back on track. The gift of salvation is for everyone. We've got to remind ourselves of that. When we talk about how we interact with each other, the gift of salvation is for everyone. It's for everyone that chooses to accept it. So if I tell a group of people that they're free, and legally they're free, and they don't believe that, they're not ever going to be free. It doesn't matter what the reality is. When we look at what the gospel is, that the gift of salvation is for everyone that chooses to accept it. The gift of salvation is grace through faith in Christ and nothing else. Sounds good. We say that a lot. Grace by faith. But what does that actually mean? What is it that we have to do then? If it was that simple, right? That's all it is. Then why all the hurt? Why all the heartache? So we know it's grace. And it's something that we have to focus on and figure out this process. The following statement was made by Ellen G. White, a week of prayer in Australia. She's what many believe to be an inspired writer, one of the founding authors in our Adventist faith. And it says, at 9 o'clock, this is her writing in a week of prayer in a newsletter, it says, at 9 o'clock I attended a meeting of students in the school chapel. About 80 were present, and the room was full. An hour was occupied in reading and in talking to them about the necessity of understanding how to exercise faith. This is the science of the gospel. The scripture declares, without faith, it is impossible to please God. The knowledge of what scripture means when urging upon us the necessity of cultivating faith is more essential than any other knowledge that can be acquired. Now, in my line of work, this presents an interesting problem, because in a school, we're teaching our kids to accelerate, right? So we want the learning to be broad, we want them to pass the test, there's all these assessments. So when I work in mentoring, and when I work in a school environment, or when I stand in a pulpit, and I read that the necessity of cultivating faith is more essential than any other knowledge that can be acquired. When I first read that, that kind of changed my approach to everything I was doing. Right? If faith is this key, then I have to look at how I can cultivate that faith. She goes on to say, we suffer much trouble and grief because of our unbelief and our ignorance in how to exercise faith. We must break through the clouds of unbelief. We cannot have a healthy Christian experience. We cannot obey the gospel unto salvation until the science of faith is better understood and until more faith is exercised. There can be no perfection of Christian character without that faith that works by love and purifies the soul. So, no matter what I do, I'm always going to come back to this point. If I'm coming here randomly and you guys decide to come back and listen, when I'm up here or stay away when I'm up here, does not bother me either way. But I'm giving you a preview now. If I'm up here, I'm going to be talking about how we grow our faith. Mm-hmm. It's the essential key ingredient to how we're going to help someone else grow theirs.
All right.
I can't help the person up the street grow their faith if I don't know. And words sound great, and I can point them to the Word, but at some point, the Holy Spirit does His part. It's nice when the Holy Spirit's working that they can see a model, right? That when I share it, they ask me questions, I'm not saying I don't know. So that means I have to grow my faith. So we're going to spend a little time on that, and in the weeks you hear me, if you're starting to say, well, why is he still talking about faith? It's always going to tie to that when I'm up front, because that's the essential key ingredient to us getting home, and that's where I want to go. The gospel process has three parts. Part one, turn with me, if you will, if you have your Bibles, or on a phone, app, however you want to get there, turn with me to Matthew 8, verses 6 through 10. Matthew 8, verses 6 through 10. That's where we're going to start with part one of this gospel process. Matthew 8, verses 6 through 10. I'm going to read from the King James Version. I use several different versions, so don't get too frustrated with me if I'm not saying a version that is easy for you. It's all right. Matthew 8, verses 6 through 10. And saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus said unto him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou should comest under my foot, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh. And my servant, do this, and he doeth, and he doth it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to them that followed, verily I say unto you, I have not found so great a faith, no, not in Israel. So this is an interesting thing about faith. Jesus himself is saying that he has not found such a great faith from a centurion in all of Israel. The centurion is from Rome, not a believer of a religious belief, right? He's out there in the streets. He works over at Target, right? He's a centurion. He's not in the church. But yet he's heard of Jesus. He's experienced Jesus. He's heard of the stories. And Jesus is looking at this man and saying that he's never seen a great faith. Well, if there's a great faith, that would mean there's a lesser faith. Right? If I'm going to have a measurement of faith, that means that all of us that are given faith, right, there's work to be done to grow it. So that means no matter where I'm at now, if God's love and God's connection is infinite, that means there's never a cap on my faith. So regardless of where I find myself, and if I think I have little faith, or I look over there and that person seems to be doing so well with their relationship with God, and when they pray, the blessings seem to flow, but when I pray, I don't know, right? I can be encouraged because there's work that can be done on faith. Turn with me to Romans 12:2. We're going to bring this from a different standpoint, because regardless of where we think we are, the Bible is telling us that faith is something that is not a certain piece that's just there forever. Faith is something that can constantly grow. And we're going to need that if we're going to work with each other and inspire others to want to grow their faith as well and get to know Christ. Romans 12, 2 through 4 says, And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by renewing your mind, that ye may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. For I say, through the grace given to me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according as God has dealt with every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, all members not the same office. I'm going to read it in the ESV. And it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern that the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to every among you to think himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of the faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and members do not have the same function. There's an interesting article there, right? The word the, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. So God is assigning the faith that I need. A lot of times when we quote this verse, we act like there's this faith. And if you have faith, then everything's okay, just have faith. But the faith that you get is not where you're supposed to stay. So it's one thing to say have faith, but if we're not understanding truly what faith is, and we're not spending time cultivating that faith and growing that faith that God has assigned me, God has assigned me this faith at the beginning. I've accepted him. He's assigned me this faith. He has a gift of salvation, and I've got to apply that faith to receive grace and mercy, and then I can move forward. But if all I'm doing is out there looking or complaining or succeeding and just saying the faith, then when I hit something and it shatters and rocks my world, be it cancer or a loss of a loved one or a loss of a job or whatever it is, and then the church folk come back to me and say, well, just have faith. Well, I had faith before that happened. That doesn't really help me. And partly because I'm not spending time understanding what faith is and understanding that I can grow this faith through Christ. And so in this gospel process, we need to understand how to grow faith. Now, there's a quick knowledge nugget I want to share with you on this grace thing, right? Because in the ESV, the title, Bibles have headings. So in the ESV version, it says gifts of grace, right? So we understand that grace is power. You guys understand that? Grace is power, right? So God's grace and mercy. A lot of times we put those together. They're actually two different things. Right? Grace is power to overcome sin. It allows us to not be tempted, fall into temptation here on earth, and live sinless in Christ down here. We all right with that? Move forward. That's biblical. Right? Not talking about being perfect someday in heaven. We're talking about grace from Christ. Me dying to Christ and him giving me his grace gives me power to overcome sin while I'm here. Yeah. That allows me to go in any street, in any place, and talk to anyone. I have power. I don't have to worry about the mistakes that I've made. I have power not to make them again. So mercy, then, is different. Right? So grace is power to overcome sin. Mercy is there in case we fail. That's encouraging. Right? So God has set it up. I'm not supposed to move. I stay within here. Right? But I move around. I get excited. Right? So God has set it up for me to deal with anything that the enemy throws at me. And because I'm born into the inclination of sin, if I fail, I have mercy. So I have grace and mercy. But it doesn't mean anything if I don't believe it. All right? So that's just a little side note. That'll be another sermon later on the whole grace and stuff, but I needed to say that. All right? So when we look at putting our life in front of God and with God, placing your life to God is a part of the first part in cultivating your faith. Part one to the gospel process is to cultivate your faith. In the message, those same verses, 12, 2 through 6, and I won't go through it all, but I just like the wording in it. I like the way it's important when you study the Bible to get a study Bible, get several different versions. Go on Bible Gateway if you need to, whatever it is. Read different versions. Now, when I prepare for a sermon, you know, my father is a pastor, my uncle is a pastor, my cousin is a pastor. So, yeah, I'm not. He goes, oh, you can get in the ministry. I'm doing my ministry. Maybe you could do your ministry. I don't need to be a pastor. I'm okay. All right. But anyways, when I do that, I like to prepare sermons with the King James Version. That's just me. But you get context when you look into these some of these other versions. Now, there are some versions that I think some people just sat at home on a weekend and wrote, and they're way off base. So guard yourself. But it is helpful to get into other versions. The Message, I like the wording. All right? Same verses, Romans 12, 2 through 6. It says, I'm down around 4, verses 4 and 6. Message kind of combines them. It says, in this way, we are like the various parts of the human body. Parts get its meaning from the body as a whole, not the other way around. The body we are talking about is Christ's body of chosen people. Each of us finds our meaning and function as a part of this body. But as a chopped off finger or a cut off toe, we wouldn't amount to much, would we? So since we find ourselves fashioned into all these excellently formed and marvelously functioning parts in Christ's body, let's just go ahead and be what we are made to be, without enviously or pridefully comparing ourselves with each other or trying to be something we aren't. If we're about dealing with each other and treating each other better and living a life that inspires the people around us to want to be a part of that, we got to recognize our role. We spend a lot of time on this earth comparing what other people, ironically in the church, how other people are being blessed in the church compared to how we're being blessed. And then confused out to why somebody that doesn't know anything about blessings or where they come from doesn't want to be a part of it. That's how we interact. Yes, we surrender ourselves to God. Yes, we ask for forgiveness. Yes, we do all those types of things. But at the end of the day, we're kind of looking at, so wait a minute. They found a job the day they lost a job, and I've been praying for a new job for over a year. God? Right? What this verse is saying is, that's not what it's about. We got to focus more on cultivating our faith. Right? We each are individuals. God deals with us as individuals. So the first part of the gospel process is to recognize that we all are given, we're given faith by God. But it's our will to grow it. Faith does not grow just based on your tenure with Christ. Your faith does not grow just simply by accepting Christ. I got baptized when I was 8. You know, I've been with God for 40-some years, so my faith is stronger. That's not written anywhere. We have to submit and choose to get to know how God works. We have to spend time in the Word. We have to actively do that. Not with a Sabbath school lesson. Not because I have to speak on Saturday. Not because I'm worried about something or my marriage is failing. Our purpose for being here is to be in the Word. We have to search the Scriptures so that we can share God's love with other people. So we can go home. Does that make sense? That's all it's about. Everything here gets burned up. You guys know that, right? So Christ is coming back. He comes back. The world ends. And so all your degrees and your PhDs and your companies, it all gets burned up. Pathfinder patches. Sabbath school medals. All of it gets burned up. So it's not just the drugs and the alcohol. Churches get burnt up. Everything down here is done. We got to go home. We got stuff to do. All right? So that's part one. The gospel that Jesus loved us so much is that he died for us and rose again. All right? So we know this, but why does it seem like this process is so hard? Could it be that just like the Jewish believers, we have somehow slipped into a works-based system? Is that where we're at? That leads us to the second part of the process. Understanding who we're up against. Because I don't personally believe there's a Christian out there that is striving and intends to be judgmental, gossip, self-serving. We know Christ. But yet we all are falling into that. When we go down, or when we don't feel, and I'll talk about that, we don't feel God's presence, then all of a sudden we start struggling, struggling. I mean, hey, I wake up a little early, devotion every day. That's what it is. I need to have more devotion. I need to worship more. Then blessings will come. It's not biblical. It's not supported in the Word. It's not there. So we need to recognize who we're up against. Satan is a master deceiver. Right? He spends all his time getting us to focus on results and actions. See, we actually think God is concerned about our results. Satan wants us to focus on our results. He definitely wants to focus on our actions. He's results given, driven. That's his process. And because we are born into sin, we have become results driven. Look at our society today. Everything is based on results. Not about what you say, it's about what you do. And what you do has consequences. Good and bad. Look at your actions. Change your actions. God's got to love you. You got to change your actions. Change them. Do better. Got to do better. You ever think and pause and think that maybe that's Satan's voice telling you to do better? What? Satan would tell you to do better? Yeah, because he can get you slipped up into thinking that you're doing better somehow gets you closer to God. As if when you do bad, you're walking this way. Oh, man. Walk here. Right? When I do bad, I walk this way. And Christ stays there. So if I do good, then I come back to Christ. We even hear that from up here. We hear that in our schools. We hear that, no failing, right? Don't fail. Don't mess up. Don't gossip. Don't drink. Don't this, don't that. Because if you guys start doing that, Christ, he's in heaven. And the more you do that, you're further away. And if you just study your lesson more, you get closer. It's not supported in the Word. I'm just telling you. So that, in my mind, comes from Satan. That mindset. These are, I'm talking about us. We're dealing against the master deceiver. Since God is in control of everything, but our will, our power of choice, everything else. You said it this morning in Sabbath school. It's always in his hands. Right? We gotta give it to God's hands. But nothing leaves his hands. Right? He's in control of everything but one thing he cannot control. He could, but it wouldn't make him God if he did, and that's our power of choice. He takes that away, Satan wins. So he leaves us with our will. And so the enemy spends all of his energies on distracting us through our minds and our bodies so that the choices we make are skewed even when we have a desire to do what God asks us to do. See, it's no coincidence that how we interact with technology today causes serious problems how we interact with technology. So I'm not sitting up here, right? It's not the internet that's the bad thing. It's how we interact with the internet. Right? Your cell phone in your pocket is not a bad thing. You want it all the time. Your choice to be on it all the time and missing the world around you, that's the bad thing. Right? So it's causing serious problems in our ability to stay focused on cultivating our faith. I need us to get this point of who we're up against. You want to know a sign of the times we are living in? Do you recognize that Satan no longer has to tempt people to do wrong? Let that sink in for a moment. We are at a point in our society where Satan no longer has to tempt us to do wrong. He actually can just affirm the actions that we do every day. See, we like to blame Satan for a lot of choices we make. Right? He put some work in back in the day. But now, we are so distracted. Everything has to be on point. It has to be now. Satan is so good that he's duped us into thinking that we are still fighting against him, but most of us aren't. The majority of us are fighting against ourselves. That's what we're up against, our own desire to know how we are doing in life. And is that better than I used to be, or at least better than my neighbor? Right? There is science that goes and supports, right? I do a lot of research on mentoring young people and millennials, right? That's that 16 to 30 year old, give or take a couple years on either side. And there's science about why they're so into the liking and social media and that, because it actually reduces dopamine, right? So when it's the same thing as like a drug, it's like gambling, it's instant gratification. Yep, it goes up. Video games, that type of stuff, but it's just an instant gratification. So if we're spending all our time doing that, what does Satan even tempt us with? He's tempting you to go on your phone? There's nothing wrong with going on your phone. What are you doing when you're on it? He's tempting you to look at your Facebook page? That's a tempt from Satan? No, that's a habit from you.
Right.
Amen.
That's your habit. Right? I mean, it used to be hard for them, right? You had people that were connected to Christ, following Christ, were in a church. Anyone could raise any child in a church. Right? I'm not that young anymore, but I'm not that old, but I'm in that transition stage. I was raised by my grandma. Right? And I do remember a time in church where there's certain things we just didn't do because anyone in the pew could say something. Now, you do you, I'll do me. You acting, child flips all over backwards over the seat? Mm-hmm. Nobody say nothing. Nobody say nothing. Kids are all standing up, iPad, watching SpongeBob and everything in the church and everything. Nobody says anything. That's not Satan. That's not the enemy. We're distracted by everything we have to accomplish. And don't get it wrong, it's not just little kids distracted watching Cartoon Network. It's us as well, going through emails, right? We don't know how to communicate anymore. If the first Sabbath of every month is supposed to be how we interact, we gotta get this resolved. This is something we have to figure out. Look at your meetings, right? You sit in a meeting, if they're talking about something you already know, you go on your phone. Hmm. Well, what if while you're reading through your phone, I don't do social media. I don't care. I don't care if you're doing an email for the next meeting. You're still not listening to the person standing in front of you. That's disrespectful. It does not represent Christ's character. And everybody in the meeting might not be a Christian, but you say you are. That's not a Christ thing to do on Saturday. That's how we conduct ourselves. I tell kids all the time, right? They want to witness. You can witness without giving a Bible study, ever. Do your homework on time. Because other people aren't. And when yours is turned in on time and right, legibly, right? And they say, why do you do that all the time? Well, it's my relationship with Christ. Huh? Boom, witness. No Bible study. Done. Move. Keep going. That's simple, right? It's practical. God is practical. But we got to figure this thing out. There's a process to this. These feel-good words and I love the Lord and salvation by faith, have faith, my brother, have faith, my sister. No, we don't have any more time for that. It's time to start spending time on what we say and who we say we are. The disciples were some messed up people. You don't know that? Disciples had issues. We were talking about it in Sabbath school. Peter is all, yeah, but you guys, I'm not dealing with the Gentiles. Paul's like, what are you talking about? How are you going to be all Christian? You can't even eat with them. That's sending mixed messages. We do the same thing today. The disciples were messed up. Do you know how they accomplished? They healed. They rose people from the dead because of Jesus in them. While they were messed up, how did they stay connected to Jesus? Their faith and allowing Him to live through them. That's not a Bible time thing. That's a tomorrow. Better yet, that's a right now. Because a lot of times we don't even treat each other right now. We can't wait until Sunday. We don't treat each other right in the church.
And it's readily available, but we have to look at this gospel process and break it down.
Let's get to our scripture, Galatians 5. I put it in there, it should have a tie to the sermon. Galatians 5. I'm going to go through this whole chapter. You guys don't mind if I read the word, right? It's okay if we read from the Bible. Is that all right here?
Yes.
Read the Bible. I mean, I can give you my opinion, but it really doesn't mean that much. I like coming from the word. So I want to go through. My scripture is 5, 2 through, I think I gave 2 through 6. But this whole chapter in Galatians chapter 5, is about Christian liberty and about love and about walking in the Spirit. These are essential components. There are a lot of congregations and a lot of people that come to church to be served. I remember when I was probably in my teens, can't remember the person, it was a pastor. She came in, guest speaker, Ephesus and Columbus. I can remember everything about the day, but what her name is. But what she said was, we come into church many times with the mindset of our glass being half empty. Right? We've heard the analogy, church is a hospital, people come, we gotta be patient, all that. She said, what would our church be like if we came with our glass full? So that when I bump into you, your glass is full and my glass is full, only thing that happens is it spills out. Yes. Spills out. What would that church look like? There are congregations and churches where people come every week. I was like 16 when I heard that. Done a lot of nonsense since then, but I didn't forget that. That's what the word does. But anyways, there are a lot of congregations that people come with and that's fine. Come with your issues. That's what we're here for. But everybody? Why are the prayer lists so long and the praise lists so short? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Isn't God the same God as always, beginning long prayer lists mm-hmm. and praise? Didn't get a flat tire this week. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Right? And back to the request, right? we're going to go through this chapter, and then we're going to get to the third part, and then I'm going to close. Fair enough? I'm almost done. All right, here we go. So, in verse 1 of chapter 5, it says, stand fast. What version am I in? I don't know. New King James, okay. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. So this is the verse right before the scripture. Indeed, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. And I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to keep the whole law. You have become estranged from Christ, who attempt to be justified by the law, you have fallen from grace. Oh, amen. So let me get this right, Paul. If I live by doing what the law says, I'm estranged from Christ. So, wait a minute. So the 28 fundamental beliefs. No, let me not go there. All right. Let me keep reading. So for we through the Spirit, verse 5, for we through the Spirit eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails nothing, but faith working through love. So here's the thing when you hear these types of concepts, right? So let me throw this out there. I'm pretty upfront, I'm an authentic person, pretty direct, right? When you hear the whole love, we need to love each other, the pushback to that is, so you say you can do anything, right? But if you look at this verse, right, well, you have to, yeah, we have to love, but if you really love God, then you wouldn't steal me, right? But it says uncircumcision or circumcision. So he's not saying, don't be circumcised. He's saying you're missing a point. He's not saying, eat meat. He's not saying, eat meat. He's not saying, be vegan. He's saying you're missing a point. Meat eater, non-meat eater. Not a factor. That's not what we're here for. He's not saying, don't play drums in the church. He's not saying play drums. He's not saying don't have praise music. He's saying you're missing the point. There is an enemy. There is a Savior. You need faith. The Savior has given you a gift. You need faith to accept it and apply it. Work on your faith. As you work on your faith, your love for Christ will grow. The more you love Christ, it will overflow to how you love each other.
Amen.
That's the process of how the gospel works. We're talking about the gospel process. Nowhere in there is Loma Linda or Worthington Foods. And just so you know, all three of the people that came with me are vegan. So I'm not saying don't. It's the healthier option. Actually, it's far more healthier, side note, than Morningstar. That actually will kill you. Read the ingredients. I apologize if I'm bit anybody, and don't get me wrong, if it's in potluck today, I'm going to eat it and it's going to be good. Because it's not the point. That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying I can't believe that you still serve grillers. And that it's loaded with sodium? That's not what I'm saying. You know, me and my wife had these discussions all the time. I work at a boarding academy. They didn't serve meat. Right? But we serve vegetarian processed soybeans every day. And I would be like, you know, it's actually better to eat organic lamb than eat that. Right? That wasn't a plea. I didn't leave the school. It wasn't something that I waved my flag and I said, I can't believe that we're tearing them away from Christ. It was just a noticing that has a little research and science behind it. It's okay. But I don't go and turn my nose up at a woman that devoted her whole day to preparing the meal.
Amen.
I come in and I say thank you and I eat that, whether it's Morningstar or not. Because it's missing a point, circumcision or uncircumcision. We're now in verse 7. Love fulfills the law is the heading in my Bible. Verse 7, you ran well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion does not come from him who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in you, in the Lord, that you have no other mind, but who troubles you shall bear this judgment, whoever he is. I'm skipping down. Verse 13, for you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Liberty is freedom. Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. That is happening today. It's happening all over the place. Right? He's saying, right? You have liberty in Christ. And what we want to do is when someone, usually a new believer, comes into the faith, ever wonder why their liberty is so on point and out so everybody can see it? Why are we the ones that want to take that away from them so quickly? They found freedom. They've been up there. They actually have real struggle. And I'm not talking about where they live, what their job is, or their social economic status. I'm saying they've been encaged by not knowing Jesus. Then Jesus is introduced and they feel free. Free from all their mistakes. Free from their struggle. Free from all that stuff. And what we want to do is say, well, you're not free to just do anything you want. What? Actually, yes, I am. See, I have liberty to say things up front that pastors don't say, because I'm not a pastor. Right? You actually do have liberty to do whatever you want. That's me
between you and God. Amen. That's not me saying, go do whatever you want. That's not what I'm saying. And if you're confused by that, I apologize. I don't want to be confusing. I'm saying that our walk with Christ gives us liberty. And you got to keep reading. I can't just pull verses out to prove my point. He says it gives me liberty, but not, right? Do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through service. So in the Bible, if my flesh wants to do anything, that's not what I'm supposed to do. Right? So when I say you're free to do whatever you want, that's whatever you want under the umbrella of Christ in your life. And so you have liberty to go what? Not do what you want, but do what God wants. And what does God want? He wants me to serve others. So when I accept Christ, I have the freedom to do whatever God wants for me. And I can do it without reserve or concern. I can go serve, whether I'm vegan or meat eater. I can serve whether I'm still struggling with my language and I curse. Whether I'm still struggling with addictions, I can still go serve. I can do that and allow God to work with those other things in my life, and I might still do that while He's returning in the clouds. But I have liberty and freedom to serve Him regardless. There's no reason why I should be standing in front of anyone talking about what I'm talking about. But I've accepted Jesus in my life. So I don't allow the devil to put that yoke on me. Amen. I take Jesus' yoke.
Amen.
Right?
Right?
So I get to live under His yoke and deal with whatever my past is in my past.
That's right.
Probably a lot of it is still some of my current.
Right.
Right? I'm not perfect. If I got a past, I got a current. I also have a future in Christ. So it allows me to serve, and that's what we're supposed to do. Part three, the final part. We're wrapping up. The final part that I want to leave you with of the gospel process is consistent celebration. Consistent celebration. In the gospel process, God wants us to focus on Him and what He has done. There's a book called Chasing the Lion by Mark Batterson. Wrote several books, Circle Maker, some other things. He references when the Israelites gained the victory over the much more equipped Philistines, right? Samuel built an altar and called it Ebenezer. It was a reminder of not only what God, it was their way of saying to the people, the God who did it before can do it again. It's a reminder that, you know, the God that brought us from there can take us, I mean, brought us from where we were, can take us where we're going, right? In that book, a point that stuck out to me is that he says our greatest shortcoming is not feeling bad enough about what we have done wrong. Our greatest shortcoming is about not feeling good enough about what God has done right for us.
Amen.
We under-celebrate and fall short of the glory of God. Short on time, I won't get into the other verses, but in Leviticus, there are several times that God commands long celebrations. Right? In Leviticus, there's an unleavened bread festival. That was 7 days. Right? That was for the exodus from Egypt. It was to remind people that when they were leaving the old life behind and entering a new way of life. That's 7 days of celebration. The tabernacles, that was a 7-day celebration. That was to celebrate God's protection and guidance in the desert. The importance was that it renewed Israel's commitment to God and trust in His guidance and protection. And did you know, for the married couples that are out there, did you know that in Deuteronomy, that God commands a year honeymoon?
Amen.
Do you guys know that? You think about getting married? And for men, it's right on point. Deuteronomy 24:5, read now the message. It says, when a man takes a new wife, he is not to go out with the army or be given any business or work duties. Hallelujah. He gets 1 year off simply to be at home and make his wife happy. right? And the reason behind that is when you start this union, right? Because this is why the divorce rate is over 51%. I know I said I was closing, but here we go. So the enemy attacks our relationships, right? Where two or more are gathered, Jesus is in their presence. That's not a coincidence. He attacks the family because if there's more than one person, Jesus is there. That's not to say he's not with you if you're by yourself. But you can worship. You can have devotion. You can build off of each other. There's a relationship there. And we can learn our relationship with an intangible Christ that we don't always see with a spouse in a relationship. So the devil intentionally comes after that. And so God knows that. So we have all this history of God saying, celebrate me. See, we get caught up in the feeling, right? The point is that God knew that sinners would need a balance, a consistent reminder of his goodness. And I think we get so caught up in feeling. Feeling has nothing to do with obedience. And I'll close it, right? Feeling has nothing to do with obedience. Don't get caught up in feeling, all right? I feel God, I feel what I'm doing. Well, I'm doing this and I feel God's okay with me. Well, I can feel God and I feel blessed. And now I don't feel God, so maybe I'm doing wrong. The devil loves that way of thinking. You go to church every week. You don't feel like you're getting anything out of the church. And now my spiritual life is just a routine. All I do is go to church. We do the same stuff that we do. What's wrong with that? These festivals were every year at the same time. Oh, by the way, the Lord asked us to observe the Sabbath. It's once a week. We didn't make that routine schedule. He did. So there's something to be said for consistency and routine. That's not a bad thing. We're sinners. Sinners sin. That's what we do. So God knows that, so he incorporated things because he's all-knowing, all-powerful. You guys need to take a break and think of me once a week, every week, because if you don't, you'll forget. When you get married, take a year. Just you and your spouse and figure each other out and put me in it and take a year. Because what's coming next? You got to be ready. You got to build a foundation. Right? Gardeners plant the seeds. They cultivate the seeds. They get the seeds ready for the stuff to grow. They don't just dump it in the ground. They prepare the soil. Take a year. Right? I brought you out of Egypt. Take a week. We're at school. We have a week of prayer. Do you know how the spiritual elevation in our school, when we have a whole week of prayer? Kids break CDs and log out of Snapchat and change their lives and ask to be baptized, all on a week of prayer. Now, generally 3 weeks later, they go back to what they were doing. Like, you know, they're us. They're just younger us, right? But if we took that week of prayer and made it a month of prayer, we do the same thing every day, focusing on Christ every day, right? So don't get caught up in this feeling thing that there's something wrong with coming every week. We always feed the homeless. We should do something else. There's nothing wrong with feeding the homeless. Same time, every week, even when you don't feel like it. Don't get caught up in that. Well, I really shouldn't be there because I don't even believe, I don't even feel what we should be doing. Doesn't matter. Go there, take your spoon, put it on the plate. Obedience. God has called us to serve. We need to celebrate God's working in our life more and longer. We're going to treat each other right. We've got to grow our faith. We only grow our faith by getting to know God more. He takes care of everything else. Thank you. Amen. Amen.
Dear Lord, thank you for another Sabbath day. Lord, thank you for your gifts of your son. Lord, I ask that you be with each family here and all those that they represent. Be with us as we move forward into the week, preparing for your soon return. Help us to be diligent about cultivating our faith so that your love shines through us to others. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.